Good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
We especially welcome our guest minister today, the Reverend Kerra.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Bless the Lord, my soul. Bless God's holy name. We observe this day as the Lord's Day, giving thanks to God,
who gives justice to the oppressed, who forgives us and redeems us,
and crowns us with steadfast love and mercy.
Let us worship the one who is worthy of our praise.
The first hymn for today is hymn number 297 in the Red Glory to God hymnal. If you notice that the fine print at the bottom of the pages of the hymns today, all the texts were written by women. Two of them were by Ruth Duck, who's one of my favorite hymn writers. She puts a lot of great texts to familiar tunes. And Jane Parker Heber, both of these women were very prolific in their hymn writing, so we get to sing some of their words today. So let us join together in Christ's call to baptize. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. God mends our broken hearts so that we can then learn to be gracious to one another. Let us now, trusting in the mercy of God, ask God together to forgive our sins. Forgiving God, we admit we have double standards.
We seek forgiveness from ourselves, but fail to forgive others.
We seek relief for ourselves,
but fail to seek relief for others.
We seek leniency for ourselves,
but fail to show that mercy to others. Forgive us, gentle God, and help us to forgive, showing others the same grace and mercy that you have generously shown to us.
This since last month, The Mission and Outreach Committee approved a small church grant in the amount of $225 to the Child Care Center to cover weekly tuition for one of our students whose sister is currently receiving chemotherapy treatments. The family was recently granted a trip from the Make-A-Wish Foundation, and the committee agreed to cover the child care tuition expenses while they were away. So this is a true example of how we, the church, and the center are building relationships with families in our community and sharing God's truth and love. Worship, discipleship, and service, that's what God calls us to do. Being and growing as God's disciples here at church and out there in the world, we're actively working to strengthen community, extend sanctuary, and welcome others to a Christian life so all can worship God. Grow as disciples and serve others. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Let us pray as we prepare our hearts to receive God's holy word. O Lord our God, our rock and redeemer, help us to hear what you have to say. speak to us today. A word about the extravagance of your mercy and the grace which we are to receive. Help us to receive it with gratitude and compassion for our fellow human beings. Amen.
Our first scripture reading today is from Genesis 50, verses 15 through 21. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and takes us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept and fell down before him and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. I am in the place of God. Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve the numerous people as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So a denarius equals about
one day's wage for somebody who's in, say, a sheets job? You know, somebody who's working in a convenience store. So anywhere between, you know, $85 to maybe $120 a day. So we're going to go with a denarius equals $100, a day's work for a laborer. So 100 denarii, which will come up later in the text, is about $1,000, if you roll with me in American money, right? Well, if you think about a talent, one talent equals 6,000 denarii. If you calculate that out, obviously you're looking at you know, what that looks like. And for, if you do the math, for the day labor, if you divide that 100 into it, that equals one talent, 16 years of labor that it's going to take to get there. Now, when Jesus talks in this parable, he's also going to use the figure 10,000 talents. Has anyone got the math in their head? 10,000 talents, $6 billion with B dollars in American money. 160,000 years of labor. So Jesus is drawing a comparison here, and I want to hear that you hear the contrast. So 10,000 talents, $6 billion, 100 denarii, about $1,000, okay? So let's hear the word of the Lord. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times. Jesus said to him, "Not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and his children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, "Have patience with me, and I will repay you everything." And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. And then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In a previous pastorate, one that was not in this particular presbytery, I experienced one of those occasions you try to prepare for but hope you never have to face. I had to confront, fire, and report a church employee for sexual misconduct with a minor. What I wasn't at all prepared for was what happened next. Some pesky questions kept coming up in various conversations with church members who were asking, "Are you sure we had to fire him? And aren't we as Christians supposed to be forgiven?" Now, my answer to whether he could stay was not just a no, it was an oh hell no. I couldn't believe what I was hearing about how he was the best custodian we'd ever had and how much he would be missed on our mission trips, and from the family itself, that he was a trusted family friend that they hated to lose his friendship. Initially, I was horrified. And then I realized that this wasn't as unusual as one might think. How many times have I watched as pastors were
being directly confronted for their illegal or immoral behavior? How many times have I known of churches held hostage for decades by bullying behaviors of one or two members who were always forgiven because of who they were? How many times do we say, forgive them for they know not what they do, when last time I checked, we aren't Jesus, and we know good and well that they know exactly what they're doing and they're absolutely getting away with it. Now, I want to take a brief moment to thank the leaders of this congregation for being transparent and talking to me about how you handled a similar incident in your congregation. It's never easy, but Pastor Aaron addressed public concern, you got legal help, and you closed some building security loopholes to try to prevent any future incidents. Those are exactly the things to do, and you did them. But you may still wonder, what is the ongoing responsibility you have as followers of Christ for practicing forgiveness? It may look or feel somewhat different now after the thing that seems unforgivable has happened during your watch. So back to the text. I find it important to note that Peter's question about forgiveness doesn't come out of nowhere. It's a follow-up question. In the preceding verses, Jesus has just explained a straightforward formula for how to confront and rectify the situation if a member of the church sins against you. And Peter wants to know, just how often should I forgive them? Because forgiveness is hard, and the kind of honest reconciliation that Jesus was proposing makes it even harder. Peter is giving us an incredible gift, the chance to hear for ourselves how Jesus responds to this spectacular question. We all want to know that answer. If following Jesus is all about love and forgiveness, we could use some practical instruction on how to do it. When we must confront someone about their sin and the damage their behavior has caused in the context of community, we don't need soft platitudes. We need actual action plans. And I'm the kind of person who wants a little more justice, please, because if we intend to have true compassion for the victims of injustice, I want the punishment then to fit the crime. Those folks in my past church jumped directly to forgiveness, far too quickly, in my opinion, and it made my head spin, and it probably signaled the beginning of my end as the pastor of that particular congregation. They were playing a little too loose with the things that matter. I'm all about love and mercy, but that's what I would call sweeping under the rug forgiveness. You see, the church had an image to uphold as a predominantly white, predominantly liberal, Lake Wobegon kind of congregation where all the women are strong, all the men are good-looking, and all the children are above average. The choices were made to protect an image rather than protect a child. Now, perhaps that's not a completely fair assessment, and certainly that wouldn't include the thoughts and opinions of everyone who worshiped there, but it sure felt like I was outnumbered, or at least outvoiced, in my way of looking at things. Now, I tell this story not to gossip about a past church, but because it's a story of a deep disturbance within the Presbyterian tribe. And if you look across the nation, our Presbyterian tribe is well-educated, mostly white, and often privileged. So unfortunately, being in the system long enough has taught me some big fat lies about what forgiveness is. It took a direct confrontation with my church to begin to feel ill at ease with what I felt were the direct and unquestioned teachings of Jesus. It all goes back to Jesus' answer for Peter, that we should forgive 70 times 7. That's how I learned it. That whole 77 rendering seems a little bit weird to me. In my Christian upbringing, I was taught that I was supposed to forgive a lot. And I think church people do forgive a lot, maybe too much, especially when the misdeeds come from the people that we know. And it's completely true that Jesus is answering this question specifically about our fellow church members. forgive someone who comes from my church, from my religious affiliation, someone who's like me? His answer is, much. More than you think you should. But when it comes to someone outside the fold of my narrative, does the forgiveness come as readily? I dare say that it doesn't. I was encouraged to believe that forgiveness should come easy to people like me. And in the courts, and in our congregations, it often does. The benefit of the doubt is a real thing, unless you're already in one of our many societal groups that are presumed guilty. You can guess who they are, right? But I was taught that if you were a good person and believe in Jesus and go to a church like mine, forgiveness just comes with the territory. And with that forgiveness comes easy exoneration. There aren't many consequences. And to be forgiven, you don't really have to work for it or even want it all that much. This is what some theologians have called cheap grace. When forgiveness starts to become tacit permission to do anything without consequence, it changes our understanding of sin and evil. Sin was something you might find, you know, out there, not in here. Sin wasn't really something you might have to deal with in your own heart, in your own soul. So no matter what our Presbyterian forefather John Calvin said about the total depravity of all humankind and our ultimate reliance on the undeserved grace of God, I still grew up being encouraged to earn my place in heaven by being good and smart and obedient. Therefore, all the goodness I could do in the world would mean that what little forgiveness I might need was certainly already granted, as God's gift freely given on the cross. Easy peasy, I'm good to go. Perhaps some of this sounds familiar. Forgiveness is so, so powerful. Therefore, forgiveness is such an easy tool to be manipulated. It has kept those with a great deal of money and power in this country quietly thinking that their upper hand on fairness is actually fair, maybe godly even, while the poor in our nation keep getting poorer. It couldn't possibly be their fault that wages are low and young people are struggling to find affordable housing. It's also why people like me are stunned by so much hatred and bigotry that now gets said right out in the open. We good church folks have been taught to give each other the benefit of the doubt when they say that they're joking or they didn't really mean it. Rather than confronting those who speak with dehumanizing words that fail to echo the love of Jesus. I find myself more and more often asking what Christ-like forgiveness is supposed to look like as the divisions among people get deeper and sadly more sinister. Are loving Christians supposed to forgive the haters and the harmful? Probably, especially if those who have injured us are genuinely seeking amends and changing their ways. Are we supposed to nationally, especially white Americans, supposed to ask for forgiveness from African Americans for their ancestors' irreparable harm of enslaving human beings? Probably. But that seems like a paltry offering, perhaps too little too late, given our national history. We might have a lot more to do if we are to achieve equality. Forgiveness can begin to feel like it's either way too much or never, ever enough. So is it 7 times? Or 70 times? Or 7 times 70 times? What does Jesus mean? Because it's so complicated, let's go back and dig into the rest of Jesus' answer so we can understand how he figures his math and how he backs up his thoughts with a parable. What Jesus is really saying about forgiveness might not be what I learned about forgiveness growing up. First off, let's take that 70 times 7 saying. What I learned this saying to mean was that I was supposed to be a doormat for Jesus, forgiving my friends and family who hurt me 1,000,000 times over if I had to. Accountability wasn't the goal. Smoothing over the relationship to make it look nice was the goal.
audience Matthew was trying to reach, he didn't mean that anyway. The number 70 is a bit ambiguous as far as what it's supposed to designate, but sevens clearly have a purpose anytime they show up. And the number 7 that both Peter and Jesus use represents the completeness of creation, the 7-day story familiar from Genesis 1. To forgive someone 7 times is to restore wholeness, to reset the creation, to begin truly anew with the person. It also matters that he couldn't buy someone's servitude for more than 6 years. In the 7th year, Hebrew slaves were set free according to Mosaic law. And as the parable Jesus uses to accompany his answer gives us an example of all debts being eradicated, I have a hunch that we're supposed to be thinking about the Jubilee year here too, when the whole society gets a reset and do-over. Now, I have my friend Rabbi Patrick to thank for those observations. In the biblical context, may it be clear that 70 times 7 is not meant to apply infinite chances for the sinner who can't seem to correct his or her behavior. It is to imply a restoration and a reset, the kind which requires transformation moving forward. But even this extravagant forgiveness that Jesus proposes has limits. For justice to truly be served, forgiveness has to be something more than unlimited chances to get it wrong in the community. The illustration that follows is meant to confirm what is being acknowledged with the 70 times 7 answer. But I find this parable frustrating and ultimately about as dissatisfying as our own experiences of trying to manage and understand forgiveness. Yes, it does speak to the tremendous power of forgiveness. The king, understood as God perhaps, has all authority to even forgive the unpayable debt and does so on the slave's groveling. One would think that the slave, the servant, would be overjoyed and completely transformed by the experience to extend the same mercy to others. But that's not what happens at all. The slave then turns around and extorts money from his fellow slave almost as soon as he gets the good news that his $6 billion debt has been forgiven, has been paid. Now, shouldn't our unfairness mode be starting to kick in at this point? Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? The answer to that, of course, is a resounding yes, of course, without a doubt. So in anger, then the Lord hands the slave over to be tortured until his entire debt is paid. That's a long time. But then Jesus says God is like that too. God will punish you if you don't forgive your brother or sister from the heart. In several of these stories about the kingdom of heaven in Matthew's gospel, God is not above punishing those who don't get with the program. If you cannot accept forgiveness and practice it, if you cannot recognize when your neighbor is hungry or thirsty and take care of them, if you aren't grateful for your invitation to the wedding banquet, then too bad for you. God has other plans. Don't keep throwing parties for the down and out. You won't get to participate. What Jesus is doing here is giving hope to the hopeless. But it tends to make those who are in the seats of power just a little bit twitchy. I think maybe what Jesus could be saying by this parable is that even God's best efforts at offering profound grace may be unable to expand the gratitude in some people. God can offer to restore us to wholeness, to press the full reset button, and there will still be those who can't or won't be able to see that as an invitation to extend such grace to their neighbor. We won't be able to see that until we're able to see that. To truly right the wrongs in our communities is going to take grit and it's going to take work. Forgiveness doesn't come on the cheap. It's there from God all the time. Offered to even the most difficult, most stubborn people, even the ones we don't want to let off the hook anytime soon. I don't believe now, nor have I ever believed, that my former custodian is outside the reach of God's love. I really don't. But without hesitation, I would be the one standing in the church doorway telling him that he couldn't come in. What I do think that Jesus is perfectly fine with is us setting boundaries for behavior and understanding in the beloved community. It's okay to say when something isn't okay. It's not our personal obligation to forgive the unforgivable. God is the one who forgives. God will take care of it in God's time. It is our responsibility to hold each other accountable, to act with grace and love as best we can in our own flawed, human, messed up kind of ways. When we forgive, it can't always be about bringing the offender back into our circle. That isn't always possible or advisable. Rather, it's about releasing the grip of the pain that it caused and being able to move on and to keep putting our trust in God's goodness even when terrible things have happened. So for my final word, I will borrow another fabulous insight from my dear friend, Rabbi Patrick. He taught me that what we do as people of faith is always an act of benevolent futility. Benevolent futility. Jesus talks his head off about love and justice and forgiveness, just as every prophet before him was known to do, and none of it has worked. What I mean by that is that we are still dealing with the same old stuff, the same old patterns of behavior, the same old frustrations. We keep dealing with people finding ways of being awful to each other, likely forever, because we're all messed up by both our pain and our sin. But God needs God's people to keep resounding the message loud and clear for all those who have ears to hear it, even if it doesn't work a lot of the time. Love one another. Forgive people when they mess up, but not by covering it up, by letting the knowledge of their wounding behavior change them, transform them, and allow them to be amazed by the fact that their blunder has been forgiven. Forgive often, but preferably in those ways that offer restoration to the community at large. Speak of God's love as extravagantly as Jesus does in every single act of worship and every study that you do. As my friend reminded me, maybe that is the most prophetic kind of thing that we do. Gather and worship and give thanks to this God who loves us way too much to let us get away with being the kind of person who gets his whole life back from complete and utter financial ruin and then extorts and imprisons his neighbor over $1,000. Benevolent futility. Yep, it's what we do. So keep sending that kind of love out into the world. 70 times 7. And now let us sing together hymn number 445 in the Glory to God hymnal. God, how can you forgive?
Thank you.
God is, so let us proclaim our faith together. The life, death, resurrection, and promise coming of Jesus Christ have set the pattern for the church's mission. Christ's human life involves the church in the common life of all people. His service to men and women commits the church to work for every form of human well-being. In the power of risen Christ and the hope of his coming, the church sees the promise of God's renewal of human life and society, and of God's victory over all wrong. The church follows the pattern of Christ in the form of its life and in the method of its action. So to live and serve is to confess Christ as Lord.
God has shown us what is good and invites us to participate in that goodness by bringing our tithes and offerings, not just to build up the church, but to build up how we serve in mission in the community. Let us now receive those offerings as signs of gratitude for God's grace. Use these gifts for your purposes, O God.
Together we pray.
Gracious God, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the oppressed, and marginalized, may they come to know the justice of God through our prayers and loving action. Together we pray.
Gracious God, hear our prayer.
For all who come into our church building weekly, including the AA and CA groups, and the children and youth in our child care center, and Life Bridge Academy, may they experience the healing power of the Holy Spirit. Together we pray.
Gracious God, hear our prayer.
For those who bear the burden of illness in body, mind, or spirit, for Reverend Keith Johnston and our friend Martha Nicholas, and for all who have died, may they rest in the eternal embrace of our loving God. Together we pray.
Gracious God, hear our prayer.
For the victims of the earthquake in Morocco and the floods in Libya, we offer our prayers. I understand that although Libya is divided into two separate governments, the West and the East, which have been fighting each other for years, the flooding occurred in the East. They received so far a lot of aid from the Western government in Tripoli. Many of those affected by the floods have said, "We cannot fight our brothers anymore." I want you to remember the power of forgiveness and God's presence. So we pray for these victims and their families, and also for the unspoken prayers on the hearts of all gathered here in person or online. Together we pray. Gracious God,
hear our prayer.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Let us now sing hymn number 772 in Glory to God, Have No Live Into Hope. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust God, and God will